one. In honor of Father's Day, I'm going to actually start the message with a video clip. So. So it's been a while since I've been back here, and a lot has happened. This is Hannah with her new boyfriend Noah. They just started dating about a month or so ago.
Go on, Hannah.
Some of you may know Noah's parents, Brett and Beth Kreider, there in the church in Northern Virginia. Brett Kreider just written a book, and before Noah started dating Hannah, I said, I want a copy of your father's book, and he gave that to me, and so I gave him permission to date. He gave it to me after they started dating. But you may see sandwiched between them, that's our dog Bella. You can just about make her, she's got this expression on her face like, what am I doing here? But we've got a dog since the last time I was here. This is Sarah. I can't remember how long ago it was, but I think the last time I heard, she wasn't even dating. And but this is her with her boyfriend Jack, and then just a couple of months ago on a beach just outside of Sydney, he proposed to her. Wow. And so now it's her fiance, Jack Meisinger. And so he's part of the church in, well, he was leading the campus in Richmond, Virginia, but just so they could both work together, they moved to Sydney, Australia, and so now they're both working together in the ministry there. And they're due to get married in August. The wedding's going to take place actually in Richmond, where his family are. So we'll be flying out there in August. This is a picture of the rest of the family. So unfortunately, Julie couldn't make it with me this morning. She's part of the worship team in East London, and so it's hard for her to kind of get away. But this is there's Julie. This is on Julie's right is her father Alex, who he came to live with us back in, 2010, I think it was 2011. He came to live with us, and then you can see my son behind me. He's the tallest in the family now, and even since this picture, he's grown a bit more. So, Julie's father. He came to live with us after his Julie's mother passed away in 2009. We had our loft converted, and he had a really nice room overlooking the park. You can just about see him there on the left. This is the east region of the London church, and he was faithfully there every Sunday. He would give out sweets to the kids. They loved him. This was a picture taken just at Christmas, and this is one of the last pictures we had of him. He passed away just about 3 months ago, and we had the funeral. He was an amazing man, and even just sorting out all his effects after the funeral, we came across lots of notes he'd made in his quiet times on various passages in the Bible, and about 3 or 4 weeks after the funeral, I was going to our local Tesco's, and one of the staff members stopped me and said, "Oh, you're Alex's son," and I said, "I am," or son-in-law, and she said, "Oh, I just want to say I'm really sorry to hear about his passing, and everyone here loved him, and he, everywhere he went, he would share his faith, he'd tell people about the church, and it was just very, very moving." And so even today, as it's Father's Day, we're thinking about him in the family. You know, One of the things we have to realise is that time goes really, really quickly. Time moves so fast. And we don't know how much time we have with our dads. And dads, we don't know how much time we have with our children. But we want to make the most of the opportunities that we do have. You know, even as I'm looking ahead to Sarah's wedding coming up in just a couple of months' time, I was already thinking about what am I going to say for the father of the bride speech. You know, and even as I was thinking it through, I was already welling up and getting kind of emotional. And I think that happens as we get older, right? we tend to get a bit more emotional, but. And I just want to show you this other video clip, which I started bawling my eyes out as I was watching this, as I was thinking of my own daughter. The parable of the prodigal son, but we're going to be focusing on the forgiving father, as it's Father's Day today. And it's a story which many of us, if not most of us, are familiar with. And before we get into the text, I want to go ahead and share the story with you in honour of Father's Day in the key of F. In the key of F. Okay, so here we go. Feeling footloose and frisky, a feather-brained fellow forced his fond father to fork over the farthings and flew far to foreign lands and foreign fields and frittered his fortune, feasting fabulously with faithless friends. Fleeced by his fellows in folly and facing famine, he was forced to function as a feed-flinger on a filthy foreign farm. Fairly famishing, he fain would have filled his frame with the food fragments from foraged fodder. Finally, folding, he fessed, "Fooey, my father's flunkies are fair far finer." And the frazzled fugitive, frankly facing backs, fled forthwith to his family. Falling at his father's feet, he forlornly fumbled, "Father, I've flunked, I've failed, I've fruitlessly forfeited family favour." The far-sighted father, forestalling further flinching, furiously flagged a field worker to fetch a fatling from the flock, and they fixed the feast. The fact I want to focus on today is the fond father's fervour for his family, and I've entitled the message, "The Forgiving Father." So let's go ahead and look at the original in Luke chapter 15. Luke chapter 15, and we'll pick up here in verse 11. Jesus continued, "There was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, 'Father, give me my share of the estate.' So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, set off for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country, who sent him to his fields to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, 'How many of my father's hired servants have food to spare? And here I am, starving to death. I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants. So he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him and kissed him. The son said to him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his servants, Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. So they began to celebrate. Meanwhile, the older son was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and asked him what was going on. Your brother has come, he replied, and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has him back safe and sound. The older brother became angry and refused to go in. So his father went out and pleaded with him. But he answered his father, Look, all these years I've been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders, yet you never gave me even a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours, who has squandered your property with prostitutes, comes home, you kill the fattened calf for him. My son, the father said, you are always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad, because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. You know, my first point is for the teens. Do you have any teens in the congregation this morning? We do. Afternoon. I asked Tim, what are some of these? He said, we've put in something for the teens, he said. And so my first point is make or break. Make or break. You know, we have the opportunity to make our Father's Day or to break it. And in this passage here, I can see at least three ways we can make our Father's Day. And the three ways, at least, to break it. You know, This kid broke his father's day by withdrawing from his father's love. You know, he comes to his father, he says, give me my share of the estate. He comes to his father, he says, give me my share of the estate. You know, in Middle Eastern culture, particularly in the first century, this simply wasn't done. To demand your share of the inheritance essentially meant you were saying to your dad, I'm impatient for you to die, and I can't wait for it, so just give me my share of inheritance right now. And he did that without any thought or concern for how it would make his father feel. You know, there's nothing wrong with a child wanting to move on and leave home, but the way he did this was so thoughtless and so insensitive. And he rejected his father's love. You know, teens, if you want to make your fathers miserable and to break their heart, well then just make it clear by your actions and your attitudes that you don't care about their love. Just kind of withdraw, pull back, you know, if they want to put their arm around you, just kind of pull away a little bit. And that'll teach them. Rejecting their love, and that'll cause some kind of hurt and pain. You know, when they want to give you guidance or input, then you can just kind of sneer and kind of mock and just, you know, say something mean like, well, just get off my case or give me some space or, you know. Or when you're out in the crowd, you know, you can make it clear that you don't want to be around them because it's embarrassing being around those old people. When you have an argument, tell him you hate him and then run away. That'll break his heart. You know, sadly, for many of us, Dad, we've experienced some of these things. But that's one way I can see in the passage how this kid just broke his dad's heart by withdrawing from his love. Another way was just by wasting what his father had given him. You know, we see in the text here that he went off to a distant land. Why? Because he was going to be squandering everything. And, you know, it's interesting how it's very rare for someone who inherits money to appreciate, to show the proper balance of appreciation and generosity. When we've not had to work for something or earn something, and I've seen this even in my own family. You know, for me growing up as a child, we didn't have very much. And so my character is such that I'm always watching the pennies. And then if I see my kids spending money, I'm like, don't you know how hard it is to earn that stuff? And you know, and I felt a twinge just a few weeks ago when Sarah rang me up. She said, "Dad, I've just been trying to plan out the wedding, and I've been getting lots of advice from lots of different people, and one of the questions that they asked was, well, how much money do you have, and how much are you going to be getting from your parents?" And I said, "Well, this is money I've saved up, and I'm sure my parents are going to give me something, but I don't know how much." And they said, "Well, you've got to ask, because otherwise, how can you budget?" And so she said, "Dad, I really feel kind of awkward about this, but I guess I just wanted to follow some advice and ask, how much you're going to be giving me during my wedding." And of course I want to give something to my daughter, of course I do, because she's my daughter, right? Yeah. But when she asked the question, oh my goodness, it did something. And I'm like, "Well, honey, I've got to kind of think about this." And, Julie and I actually discussed this very thing about 3 months ago, back when, because Jack had asked me long ago if he could propose to my daughter. He was just waiting for the right time. And so we knew this day was coming. And so we'd already started to figure out our finances, how much can we afford. And so we'd set aside a sum of money, a large sum of money, in my estimation, towards the wedding. And it was £5,000 that we'd set aside towards the wedding. And so when she asked me, "How much are you going to be giving us?" I said, "Okay, hold on a second, well, where's the wedding going to be? Because they're in Australia, right? And it's not cheap to fly to Australia. And if the wedding was in the UK, well, then I could just give her that 5,000. But if it's in Australia, well, then we've got to pay for flights." So, well, we're thinking of getting married where Jack's family is, in Richmond, in Virginia, in the States. Because Sarah worked in the States for a couple of years, so she has friends over there as well as in the UK. And so I'm calculating how much is it going to cost to fly out there, and when is the wedding going to be? In August, peak travel time. And I said, we had set aside of 5,000, but it's likely we're going to have some expenses to cover and everything else, and so I can't give you a figure right now, but let me think about it. And honestly, I had to go away and pray afterwards. And then I had to get some advice from Mohan, who was discipling me. I said, "Bro, I'm feeling all these things. What's going on?" And when I talk to other fathers, they're like, "Oh, yeah, that's normal. Yeah. But for children who inherit money, to have that kind of balance. Oh, by the way, I did, in the end, I gave her the whole 5,000, just so you know. But to have that balance of appreciation and generosity. And, this son, he wasted what he was given. And we can so easily waste things that we've been given, can't we? A third way I can see how he could break his father's day was just violating his father's values. The Bible tells us that he even when he was thinking through coming back to his father, he said, "I'll go back to my father," and he said, "I'll tell him, Father, I've sinned against heaven, I've sinned against you." The fact is, he knew he'd violated his father's values. He knew that he'd compromised the things that his father held dear. For dads, especially Christian dads, our desire for our children is we want them to grow up with godly values. Ultimately, we want our children to grow up loving God the way we do, right? If I can go to my grave knowing that all of my children are disciples and they're married to strong Christians, then I can feel like I've actually done a good job. But that's what we desire. And so for this child to go away and to spit on the values of his and the standards of his father held dear, that's heartbreaking. That's heartbreaking. But we don't want to break up our parents' hearts. And so I can see in the passage here three ways in which he actually made his father's day. Firstly is he sought his fellowship. he came back and he decided to, you know what, instead of, I withdrew from my dad, I rejected his love, but now he desired to be in fellowship with his dad. The second thing I can see, he showed respect. You know, when he left home, he left well-dressed, but he came back in rags. He left clean, he came back dirty. He left pure, he came back tainted with sin. He left arrogantly with this, give me my share of the estate, to make me a servant. He came back with a humble spirit, respecting his dad's authority. And you know, if we want to make our Father's Day, show respect and appreciation for the role that God has given them in your life. And thirdly, he had a positive spirit. You know, the dad's response was, when he saw his son, let's kill the fattened calf. I heard of a teacher teaching a Sunday school class. And they asked the kids, so who was the only person who wasn't happy when the youngest son returned? And one kid put out his hand and said, it was the fattened calf. But he said, hey, let's have a party, let's celebrate. Why? Because my son was lost and now it's found. And the son didn't, the younger son wasn't like the older brother who refused to go in, but he actually participated. You know, a lot of kids, they can, especially teens, there's something that happens when you go through adolescence that suddenly changes your angelic little child to something from the other place and not from heaven. But that only lasts prayerfully for a few short, for a small period of time. But there's something that changes them, and maybe it's they're exercising their desire for autonomy. They're exercising their desire to be their own person, to test boundaries and everything else. But they go through their teenage years. It's amazing how they can transform from being the kid who wants to come and sit on your lap to now, if you try and give them a hug, they're like, back away. And they can be really happy and hanging out with their friends, but then they come home and immediately just this cloud descends, and now it's this moping around the house, let me just lock myself in my room and hibernate, let me get on my phone and on social media, and they can be grumbling, you say come down for dinner, and they're like, do I have to, you know, and they can have that just a negative spirit that, oh my goodness, but this kid, he joined in. And it was a change from how he left. You know, having a positive spirit, what a way to make our Father's Day. And another way, which I thought of, which is not in the text, but think about this. The older brother was the one who was grumbling and complaining. But imagine if the older brother had the same spirit as the dad. The same spirit of, you know what, my dad, he saw his youngest son from a distance. That meant he must have been looking out for him, right? He could see how his father loved and cared for his younger brother. He could see how he yearned for his return. He could see all those things. Imagine if, as an older brother, he decided, I'm going to go out and find my younger brother. I'm going to seek and save the lost and bring him home. Imagine how that would have changed the story. So it wouldn't just be, hey, let's kill the fattened calf because my younger son is found. Let's also kill another fattened calf because my older son, he's found my younger son. I mean, it'll be a celebration all around. You know, we can make our Father's Day by loving our siblings. Now, of course, this is a point for the teens, but I think we can all get something out of it, right? Because in exactly the same way that we can make or break our earthly Father's Day, isn't that the same way how we can make or break our Heavenly Father's Day? How we hurt God when we withdraw from His love. How we hurt God when we waste the gifts He's given us. Even amazing gifts. Even the gift of the Word of God. What a tremendous gift. And yet we can so easily take it for granted. The gift of prayer, to enter into that Holy of Holies, and that path was made available because of Jesus' death on the cross. And yet we can go our days not appreciating the gift of prayer. You know, we can waste the freedom that we've been given in Christ. Or we can violate God's values when we go off to a distant land so we can sin. When we're away from God, so we can compromise. But in the same way, we can also make our Father's Day by having just seeking his fellowship, trying, looking for ways we can get more time with our Heavenly Father. Being excited about coming to church and being with his family, instead of just showing up out of duty. You know, showing proper respect for his authority and appreciating the commands he's given us, and having a positive spirit, just a desire just to really just appreciate the cross, not just on a Sunday, but every day of the week. You know, even just like the older brother, we can go out there and seek and save the lost. And we can give God a gift that he doesn't currently have. Helping the lost to be saved. You know, that's for the teens. My second point, though, is for everyone. And the first point is make or break. The second point is servants or sons. Servants or sons. And you know, so much of how we view God and how we behave, how we behave is totally dependent on how we view God. You know, it's interesting because this very story of the prodigal son, Bible scholars will tell you that the Jewish rabbis, they had a similar story to this years before Jesus came on the scene. But in that story, the younger son went off and squandered his father's wealth, then came back, and when he came back, the father rejected him. And the father sent him away. And, you know, there was a Jewish custom in the first century called kizaza, which was a ceremony that would occur if a son squandered their inheritance amongst the Gentiles, and then they want to come back to the community, the elders and of the village would come, they break a pot in front of that child, and dismiss him from the community. Kizaza. And so, the story that they told about this boy being rejected by his dad, and he would plead and beg, but there was no hope for him, because he'd already made spent his inheritance with the Gentiles, so he could live with the Gentiles. That story kind of reflects their view of God. That God was this very kind of strict judge, just waiting to condemn. Let me show you this. This is a very, very short clip, right? It's about 7 seconds long.
I'm scared, Dad.
You trust me, son?
Yes.
Come on, son. Rule number one, never trust me.
Sorry, it's not true, okay? It's set up. But, if your view of God is, wow, he's a hard-line God, he's a hard-line father, just waiting to teach me, you know, the hard way to learn the lessons of life, rule number one, don't trust anyone. Wow, then that will inform the way you behave, right? And with the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, oh my goodness. Let me show you something. If you go back to the beginning of the chapter, in Luke chapter 15, Jesus told this parable. It was a third of three stories. And he told this story in chapter 15, verse 1. He says, the tax collectors and sinners were all gathering around to hear Jesus. But the Pharisees and teachers of the law muttered, this man welcomes sinners and eats with them. Then Jesus told them this parable. And he tells them the parable about the lost sheep. And someone's got 100 sheep, and one of them goes missing, and he leaves 99 and he goes searching for that lost sheep. But you've got the tax collectors and the sinners, and they're all there looking to hear from Jesus. Of course, Jesus' disciples are there as well. But then the third group of people are the Pharisees and the teachers of the law. And they're muttering, they're like, what is Jesus doing with these tax collectors and sinners? And so Jesus tells them these three stories to show them just how much God desires the lost to be found. And he talks about the lost sheep, and you know, the sheep goes missing, and you know, when a sheep finds itself lost, you know what it does? It does nothing. It doesn't go anywhere, it freezes. And, and when it's lost and then separated from the rest of the flock, all it will do, it'll stay in place and it will bleat. That's all it will do. And the shepherd has to come rescue that sheep. And even when the sheep hears the voice of the shepherd, it still carries on bleating, doesn't do anything. And that's one of the reasons why the shepherd would have to pick up that sheep and bring him back. And, you know, a sheep weighs, what, 50 pounds or more? But to carry a sheep home, if it's not a lamb, to carry that home, that's pretty intense. That's hard work. And yet, at the end of this parable, what does Jesus say? He says there is more rejoicing over in heaven. I mean, the shepherd's overjoyed he's found the sheep. And he's like, well, this is fantastic. Even though it was a lot of work on their part. You know, the second story he tells is one of the lost coin. And the woman's got 10 coins, and what happens? She loses one. And what does she do? She searches and sweeps house and does everything until she finds that coin. You know, when a coin is lost, what value does it have? Nothing. You can't spend it. But when you find that coin, now it means something. And what does she do? She throws a party. She gets all her neighbours in. I found this coin. I hope the coin was worth more than the party she threw. But she was overjoyed because she found it. And Jesus uses that as an example to say, you know, in heaven, when one sinner is found, oh, there's rejoicing in heaven. And then it's in that context that he tells this third story. And of course, this third story, well, who does the older brother represent? It represents the Pharisees. Because they're the ones, like in the story, that they're the ones who are grumbling and complaining about the fact that, what is he doing throwing a party for this younger brother? He's squandered the inheritance, he's done this, he's done that. What? And he's upset. And he should be rejoicing. And that chapter ends with the father having to defend why they're celebrating. Twice he says, this son of mine was dead and now he's alive. He was lost and he's found. And he's having to defend, and we don't hear the rest of the story. But it's the Pharisees and the tax collector. It's the Pharisees and the teachers of the law who are, they just got the wrong view of God. The wrong attitude. Let me show you the right view of God. Because see, God isn't this authoritative legalist just waiting to punish, but rather he is this compassionate father who is just waiting for us to take a step towards him, and he comes running towards us. In fact, there's very little we can do if we are lost. If we're that lost coin, what does it do to be found? It can't do anything. What does a sheep do? It bleats. There's very little we can do, but God does all the work for us, the bulk of the work. We just have to respond his overtures of forgiveness. And you know, we can view the father as being this harsh, unforgiving individual, or we can see him as he really is, a God of love. In fact, he's portrayed as a father who just wants to be in a relationship with his sons. He wants to have just a relationship with his children. And so when the younger son was sitting in the pigsty with the pigs, longing to eat of their food, he comes up with this plan. He says, I'm going to go to my father and I'm going to ask him to make me one of his hired servants. You know, there are two Greek words for servant. You've got doulos, which is the word that Paul most often uses. It's pretty much means slave, that we're in complete subservience to the master. Or you've got mythios, mystheos, and that one is a servant who is paid. He's a paid servant, and that's the word that this son uses whilst he's in this mess, because he understands I can't go back because they're just going to perform kazaza on me and that's it, and I'm going to be excommunicated. But maybe if I can make restitution, if I can go back, and if I can earn some money, and then I can then maybe pay off my debt, and I'll be a hired servant. But that's not what the father was interested in. The father wanted him as a son. And so what does he do? He calls servants and says, hey, put a robe on him. Get sandals for the feet. You know, it was the servants didn't wear sandals. It was only the sons who wore sandals. put a ring on his finger, a symbol of my authority. He's killed the vanguard. He rolled out the red carpet because God's more concerned about relationship than restitution. And see, that's the way God is. That's the compassionate, kind, merciful, loving Father that we have. I want to show you this. This.
I'm scared.
This is a picture of a girl by the name of Mackenzie Cayley, and Kerry, Kenzie for short. But she has soon after she was born, she was diagnosed with an illness called mitochondrial disease, which kind of leads to just a lack of energy for her body. Her muscles begin to waste, and she can't really move and everything else. But her dad just wanted her to really just participate in life. She's in a wheelchair, she can't walk on her own or anything. But her dad is just really wanting her just to really live a full life. And he would enter her into these summer fetes and pageants and everything else. And he would help her to dance by pushing her wheelchair around. Let me show you a clip. This is her just this year at the age of 15. But this clip is from when she was 11.
Yeah.
No, that's the God that we serve. It's a God of love, God of compassion. In verse 20, when he saw his son in the distance, the Bible tells us that while he was still a long way off, his father saw him, was filled with compassion for him, and he ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. You know, the word that Luke uses here just for run, it's dromon. It's the same word as trako, as different tense in the Greek. But it's the same word that Paul uses in 1 Corinthians 9, where he talks about running the race. It's a technical word. It means literally to race. And his father raced toward his son. You know, a Middle Eastern man, 40 plus, having to run. He had to pull up his long garments. So undignified, so not done. But because he loves his son, he's filled with compassion, he races towards him. That's what God does for us. And even the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, you know, represented by the older brother in the text, you know, when the son refuses to come into the party to celebrate, the dad comes out to him. Which again, to leave his guest at the party, that's just not done. But he humiliates himself. Because he loves his son. And even the word, when he comes to him, he says son. You know, the word he uses in the Greek is tekon, or tekon. The normal word for son is chios. But tekon, it carries an extra meaning of affection. He comes after him, and instead of saying get it together, he says, son, my boy. He said, we have to celebrate. And his reason for him, why? Because he loves him. And this is Jesus' love even for the Pharisees and teachers of the law. That's the God we serve. And because we serve a forgiving Father, we're not servants, we're sons, then we want to do our best to make our Father's Day. By loving him, by respecting him, by valuing what he values, and by seeking and saving the lost, just as Jesus came to do. Amen.